Avatar. I come to you with a wing and a prayer. Today is October 12th, but tomorrow is October 13th, which is Eruch's birthday. I wanted to do a tribute to Eruch, and I wanted to highlight his life, but what I realized, and I had to redo my whole play, is that the highest tribute you can pay to a slave is to honor his master. So today we will honor Avatar Meher Baba and his relationship with his slave, Eruch Jessawala. We got a little card, which I'm gonna have all of you guys sign because we're part of this birthday celebration. Tomorrow is Friday. Mara's not as close, so we wouldn't have a chance to greet Eruch on that day, so we're doing it a day early. It's October 12th. How'd that be? I got the plane to do a flyover, okay? There's no time. I'm going to have accompaniment today from Simon Reese on the guitar, who is my favorite musician. I want to write right now in here something that I want to use as a theme for my little play today, which is, Simon, give us a little music, which is a Baba quote, and it's about art and playing. It says, "Do not play to the gallery." I'm going to write that. Do not play for the salary. To the infinite God within. That is by Meher Baba. Send this around now. Anybody, as this show goes on, just sign your name. We're part of this show today. It is an incredible thing to watch somebody volunteer to be their life, to be a slave. I want to start out with a story that Eruch told me years ago about the Buddha. A man who heard that the Buddha had a touchstone, means something that you rub, and when you rub against it, no matter what metal it is, it becomes gold. And this man felt what a powerful tool that would be to have, and he heard that the Buddha had it. He searched out the Buddha through difficulties and found him, and he said, "Are you the one that has this touchstone that turns anything that touches it into gold?" And the Buddha said, "I'm the one who had it, but I threw it away." He goes, "Where did you throw it?" He said, "You see that hill out there, way out there beyond that one? Somewhere I was on top there, it's there." So that man runs feverishly. He can't stop, he can't breathe, and he gets to the hill and he's touching every rock, every stone, and he's rubbing. He's exhausted, but delirious at the thought that when he finds it, he will be the king of the universe. After some time, and in total exhaustion, he found that touchstone, and he saw that when he rubbed it against the metal, it turned into gold. When he saw that happen, is all of it here? Like all of us sometimes at Baba functions, he falls straight back and becomes numb. And when he became conscious again, He realized the magnitude of his wealth. And what happened is, he went back to the Buddha. And the Buddha sees him and he says, oh, you're the one who came to me for that touchstone. Did I give you the right directions? Did you find it? He says, yes, I found it. He goes, wow, that's good. You must be happy now. And the man says to Buddha, I also threw it away. He goes, why did you do that? You were so feverish in your intent to find it. Why would you throw it out like that? And he said, because I thought about you. And I thought that you had this in your hand and you could have been the most powerful man in the world, but you threw it out. You must have something in your possession that is greater than this touchstone. And I want to come to your feet and find what that is. In tying in our storylines today, when Eruch said to me and us for years, I offered my freedom to become his slave. I exercised my freedom to become his slave. He also could have had that touchstone of life, but he came to our orbit here to serve Meher Baba and be his slave. I again salute that incredible thing and gesture. Eruch. Who could imagine what it is to do that? Because Meher Baba is the lion of love.
What's the matter? I've never seen a ferocious lion before. I have a message. I said I have a message. From my elder brother, Meher Baba, the lion of love. Baba says, my lovers may be likened to one who is fond of lions and admires them so much that he keeps a lion in his own home. But being afraid of the lion, he puts him in a cage. The lion is always in cage. Even when he feeds the lion, he feeds the pet animal from a distance and from outside the cage. Baba is treated like the lion by the lovers. There is love. There is admiration. There is an intense desire to see Baba comfortable and happy. And Baba is also frequently fed by the love of the lovers. But all this is done keeping Baba segregated from one's own self. What is wanted of the lovers is that they should open the cage and through intense love throw themselves inside the cage to become food for the lion of love. The lover should allow himself to be totally consumed by his own love for the beloved. There's more to the message. Baba says, in spite of all explanations and discourses, words remain mere words. They do not take one any further than intellectual satisfaction. Only love for God works the miracle. Because love is beyond mind and reason. Where then is the necessity to read? I authoritatively say, I am the Ancient One. I have been saying this to all the world. If you love me with all of your heart, you shall be made free eternally. Jacob. Woo!
Personal story that ties into today's affair that makes me very happy and very glad. My brother is here visiting from America. That's Gary Kleiner over here. His friend Marissa is over there. 3 years ago on Eruch's birthday, we're sitting around and just having a cup of tea. And Eruch says out loud, he says, Gary, when are you coming to see me? And I wrote it on a piece of paper, and I said, Eruch, hold this like this, and I'm going to take a picture because he's not going to believe me that I said that you said we need proof. Eruch takes the piece of paper, and in his own hand, he writes, Dear Jerry, J. Baba, it is my wish to see you before I cross this illusory ocean.
Oh.
Much love, Eruch. October 13th, 1997. Tomorrow, that's 3 years. So today, it is unbelievable pleasure to me personally that in some small way, I could have been there and played a part in having Eruch's wish come true.
Gary, will you put that sign in front of Eruch and let me get a close-up?
Hold on, Jerry. Wait, Jared, you stand up just for a second? All right, this is your sign. Judy needs a photo. Watch this.
Hold it up so I can get a close-up.
Jerry says, I'm here, Eruch.
Let me see it. Wait. Have him stand there and have this here. Okay. Eruch, hold it up in front. Eruch.
She wants to hold it.
Everybody. Yeah.
Okay, hold still. Just a second.
All right.
Wait. Too cool. Okay. All right.
Okay.
How cute that was.
Don't get nervous. I have a gun. This gun is symbolic because although I never met Meher Baba, in my story with Eruch and as a representative of that love, one of them, he put a bullet in my heart. And it is that bullet that lives and continues with my story. For that, I am eternally grateful. And I have a story about this, which Eruch, we interacted in a play, personal drama. Because what I always craved, and I did not understand that it is not possible, is that when someone like Eruch became exercised his freedom to become the slave of Meher Baba, he gave everything of himself away that there is nothing left. It reminds me of a story when Baba calls in Eruch right here. Baba must be sitting in this chair, and he asked Eruch to sit in front of him. And he said, "Do you love me?" And Eruch says, "I wasn't there, I'm only repeating what I hear. I don't know, Baba." And whenever I would hear that, I'd go, "You don't know? What are you talking about, you don't know? You gave up your whole life, you don't know if you love the guy? If he asked you, do you love your mother, can you say yes?" Because I'd say yes. I go, "Why can't you say yes to him?" Because I don't know. And Baba said, kiss me on the cheek, and tell me you love me." But what I realized in putting together this little show is that when a slave gives himself away completely, there is no room to even give love. You have everything of mine, I have nothing more to give you. So that concept was unbelievable, and it ties into a story with me. One time I'm sitting with Eruch at the trust office. We have a great relationship, we have fun. He is a representation of my higher self, and I'm a representation of his lower self. So we have fun with it, and there is the love that is contained within the boundaries that are allowed. But as I'm sitting there with him and having a cup of tea, I say, "Eruch, if Meher Baba told you to take a gun and put a bullet in my head, you would just do it." And he saw what that meant to me, because the people who we love, we cannot do those kinds of things to each other. But he chose to answer the question, and he said, "Yes, I would." And on hearing that, whatever feelings I had of personalness, whatever desire for, like, hey, we're buddies, it was shattered. And then Eruch, there's some stuff going on around the table, and then he turns to me and he says, "But why do you take it that way? If he, Meher Baba, if he asked me to do that to him, I would do it." So that kind of a surrender is out of this world and unbelievable. And to keep on the point of slavery, I believe the last thing that Meher Baba asked for on January 31st, 1969, the day that he passed away, was for this board to be brought to his bedroom at this side over here. Is there an alibi here? I would have read the Persian if there's a... Here, Peter Booth is there.
I can do it.
Where is it?
He's coming right now.
Alibi's coming right now. We'll just hold it for a second, because we'll hear, because Baba enjoyed the original, the Persian Hafez. But what a beautiful translation we have. Just by chance, as you, this is street theater, it's not planned. Alba is walking in here. The lion is coming.
All right, the lion.
Another slave of the beloved Alba.
Okay.
Gary, you want to move?
J Baba, please, all.
J Baba.
Now the second point, very important. Jal Bhai phoned me from Mehrabad that please release one bus sharp at 12 from here. So you have to decide which part of the world and collect yourself and don't be taken.
You go. Okay. That was not part of the show. Who is one of Meher Baba's dear disciples. I don't know if it was you who on January 31st, 1969 brought this Hafiz quote to Baba's bedroom.
It was Baba told me 30th, that bring the harvest board here tomorrow,
Gary.
31st. So I asked what time Baba vomit like that, 10 o'clock, 10 o'clock daytime.
Yeah.
So when I took this board, it was fixed here, I took to Baba's room. Baba in, you know, not good condition, this, that. So just Baba simply told me to put it there, and I kept it there.
Okay. You read the Persian, I read the English. Let's let people hear. Can you see that far?
Yes, why not?
Okay.
مزام زچون چرا آدم که بنده مقبل قبول کار به جان هر سخن که سلطان گفت. This is first line.
Befitting a fortunate slave, carry out every command of the master without any question of why and what.
چوبش نوی second line. چوبش نوی سخن آل دل مگو که خطا است سخن شناس نی دل برا خطا اینجاست.
About what you hear from the master, never say it is wrong, my dear, because the fault lies in your own incapacity to understand him.
بنده پیر مغانم که ز جهلم برهان پیر ما هر چه کند عین رعایت باشد.
I am slave of the master who has released me from ignorance. Whatever my master does is of the highest benefit to all concerned.
I should tell you a little background of it, how it came to existence. We were at Satara. One day Baba told me, he dictated that three lines from office. And this is very important. Ever fresh, ever useful, ever practical, these three lines. Yeah. All right. Baba told me write down with chup kalam. Chup kalam means big, big, big like that, not small like that. So I got it from bazaar and like this or that. And my handwriting was very good at the school. And I wrote it for, I practiced for 1-2 days. And after that, I made it like this. After that, one day it came, and Baba immediately gave his translation by himself. This translation of three line of his is direct from Mehr Baba, author of the age, not from any of any person. All right. After that I got this, it came to my mind, one should write in nice English handwriting. So Balaji Natu, our Bal Natu, said, someone is a good body, his handwriting is nice. I said, please do it. So we sent to, Balaji sent to Kurulwadi, and that man, request that man to write it nicely, and it came. And after that, it became universal. You go to Bombay Center, it is there. Mehrabad, Mehrazad, everywhere is like this. Now it becomes many more other places. One other good news for all of you. Nowadays, awakening Iran towards Mehr Baba, tremendous. It is really a miracle. Many new centers, which called Mahfil in Iran, came up. They come to hear Baba, to listen to Baba's with the enthusiasm, show with enthusiasm. And many wanted to come. And yesterday I got a letter from Shiraz. They wanted to invite me to Shiraz. Baba spoke to them that you can invite Aloba, but Aloba will not come. He has great responsibilities at Mehrabad, but Mehrazad here. So this is the position. If before that, before this, he had they invited me, I was saying that the same reply that they will not come. And Baba said, you invite him, but he will not come. By the way, please find out the passenger of one bus that should leave here 2 o'clock.
We'll work it out. The show has to go on, Alaba.
No, go on. I'm more practical than you.
I know you are. Today I am impractical. Thank you, Alaba. that was a commercial for Iran and they helped sponsor the show. Like Eruch always says, this is not an empty chair because he feels any representation of Baba is the window through which we can touch the infinite. Very few of us see somebody in that chair right now, but I brought my avatar perfume. Put on a little bit, this is for Eruch's birthday. Put on, we're gonna, if we can't see anyone in that chair, at least let's have the whiff of the avatar in the air. Anybody?
Avatar perfume.
Avatar. I'm gonna tie in one more story with my brother. This is a stretch, a little fiction, but there is a truth about this because this has to do with the theme of slavery. When my brother came here 13 years ago, he's sort of a tough guy and he's always, and I wanted Eruch to tell real manly stories about how, that, let's say, I didn't want my brother to feel that I came to an ashram and it's a little feminine and we just bow down to furniture and just kiss roses and put it over here. I wanted some manly stories. There's some stuff going on here, yeah. So I had Eruch tell stories about driving for 8 days without sleep. Anybody came up to Baba and they weren't supposed to be there, boom, he slid out. Those were power-packed stories. And Jerry got a real good impression that there was this character who he met was a man of strength. And he said to Eruch, you know what I think? We were sitting out here. Let me just, so as you know, there's all these pictures of Meher Baba outside. And my brother says to Eruch, he goes, you know, Eruch, I think there should be more pictures of you up here and not all of Meher Baba, because the way I see it, you did most of the work. Here's the thing, here's what I gotta say about that. Literally, this is literally true. And some of you who know Eruch's condition, you'll see what I mean by this. Eruch's jaw dropped. He just went like, huh? Because his sadness, although it was playful and we had fun, his sadness was that, did he misrepresent his beloved in such a way that the glory came to him? And I say, symbolically, that now that Eruch has a condition where that jaw droops, I say it started 13 years ago when he delivered that line to Jerry, okay?
Oh, Jerry.
Jerry, in a way, you are the cause.
I am. Yeah, that's what they're saying. Playfully, but I want to stay with this theme of what it is to be in a place where there is no room for anything else except your beloved. In America, I always do funny little things with Eruch, and from America, I sent him a little postcard that said, "Hey, gorgeous," and it said, for me, it said, "This is a correspondence-free postcard. Just write, I love you, to the person it is addressed to, and sign it, and everything else is free." And I put in, fill in the box, there was a little box. So I always have a little joke with Eruch, because one of his favorite lines is, because as things became too overwhelming, and just dealing with the world of like, and people's need to be attached with the Baba story, at some point Eruch said, "A friend is he, and a friend is she, who keeps me correspondence free." So my joke here is that if I put the postage on, it's correspondence free, just right here in the box. But the beauty of Eruch is that he could take anything that is playful and something real will emerge out of it. So in relation to my theme here today, Eruch writes in the box, "Dear Gary, J. Baba, I love you, dear Gary, because you love the Lord of my heart, Avatar Meher Baba. Eruch, on May 13th, 2000. And it took me a long time, but I have come to terms that if I engage with a slave of the beloved, I have to humble myself to his master. Thank you.
One more thing, dauntless.
Today's the day to talk, one thing you will have to talk is a busload of people.
I don't even get this concept that the buses are here. Why does it have to go back?
Yeah, because it's practical.
It's a school bus.
School bus, and it has to be at the school at 12:30.
It's required.
Oh my God.
Oh. The street theater, you'll click.
Okay, so here's what I'm saying.
We volunteer.
Who came on the bus? Go.
The presentation, and then let people go to the bus.
No, this is the presentation. No. Okay, who went, who came here on the school bus?
Yeah.
All right, I'm a fortunate slave.
All right.
Okay.
That's horrible.
Wow. So let's take, how's this? Are we going to get volunteers? This is just happening here. Are we going to get some volunteers to go on this?
Yeah.
Or, yeah? Okay. Whoever goes, goes. Okay. I got to cut to the edge here. We're not finishing yet. But it is, what we're doing today is also celebrating Eruch's birthday. And as I said, to say happy birthday means, to me, we're happy that somebody was born because we were touched by their life, their story, their love. And so, because some people may be leaving in a few minutes and they would have loved to have participated, although we were going to save it for the end, let's sing happy birthday to Eruch, okay?
But you're just starting yours.
This is part of my talk. This story is part of my talk.
Is that true?
Yeah. No, go ahead, please.
The thing is that what had happened was one day when there was a large crowd of people, thousands of people were there, at Guru Prasad. There was a huge tent put there for thousands of Baba lovers who had come from all parts of India and from America, Australia, England and all that. You ever heard of Easter's gathering and all that?
In 1962, Baba had a gathering of people coming from all over the world, the Eastern world, Western world.
Thousands of people were there. So he is there, he's sitting there, the people are paying respects and bowing down to him, bringing bananas and garlands and baskets of sweets and packets of chocolate and some scent bottles and this and that and all. And I am there by his side, collecting all this and keeping this. A huge pile of things there. And Baba is, Baba blesses and Baba smiles and Baba goes on. Everything is fine. People are happy about it. All of a sudden he turns to me. Totally mood is changed. And it's a very irritable mood. It looks very serious. And says, tell them loudly. Little loudly. I have to not only translate his gestures but also his moods also. So he tells me to tell people, the crowd there, stop all this. Why are you bringing all this to me?
Don't
you know who I am? I am the very sustainer, provider, creator. What's all this for? I'm the one who has provided this, and why do you bring all this to me? Returning all that I have given you? So I say it loudly like that, in an irritable mood, as if Baba is saying. Baba, the pin drop silence. Everything was very happy, in a very happy mood and everything, and all of a sudden it changed. I was myself surprised. And then Baba puts his hand on his head and says, nobody offers me what I need. And some voice from far away, the woman's voice, lady's voice, said, Baba, please let us know what you need so that we can offer you. Baba looks at them and says, nobody offers me what I need. I am perfection personified. I am the sustainer. I am the provider. I am the creator of everything. And nobody gives me what I need. Again the woman says loudly, but Baba, please let us know what you need so that we can offer you. Nobody offers me. Nobody offers me. Again he says the same thing. I am perfection personified. I am the one who has given everything to you, and you return all this to me. Nobody gives me what I need. Then they cry from other people or something, Baba, let us know what you need. All that I need from you is your imperfection, which I don't have. All that I need is your imperfection, so that you may be relieved and I may be released from your heart.
Beautiful.
That's all.
I don't know, Eruch, in this street theater here, this is not planned. Do all of you believe this? Eddie Box, who is a chief Native American elder, just walked in here and he wants to give you something. I don't know if it's what you need, but he, part of this offering of today, he wants to give you something, Eruch.
Very good opportunity.
Oh.
Thank you.
Now it's 12.
Anybody, any volunteers here? I can't push you off, but we're looking for a volunteer army here. We're gonna do it.
That's it.
Some people are staying until 12:30, where the show must go on.
So those who came on the school bus are going back on the school bus?
No, it's volunteers. Yeah.
But we can pack the two other buses.
I'm going.
Okay. You guys are going? We'll
goodbye, sir.
Okay.
Yes, on the bus.
You're on the bus to make room? Okay. Chairs available soon.
Give me a little background music.
I want to share something that I learned in my association with Eruch and with Meher Baba here. This concept comes, that I heard here in the hall from Baba's sister, Mani. Mani would say that what Baba is, the infinite ocean, it is too big for us to comprehend. The ocean has no top, no bottom, no sides. How can we approach it? Meher Baba, in the form of the avatar, comes and creates a shoreline for us, by which means we approach the ocean. Meher Baba, this is Gary's words now, is a beach. We go to the beach with him. There is a beach called Meher Baba. Other beaches are Ram, Krishna, Zoroaster. Whatever beach gives you the approach to the ocean. There is no blame, no shame, no guilt of whatever brings you into the water. It is always wonderful for me to see that although Eruch was the slave of Meher Baba, he knows that the ocean is equally approachable from whatever beach you are on. Therefore, if it is your religion, your belief system, your love, whatever brings you to the love game with the infinite, whether it is this empty chair, whether it is Meher Baba's samadhi, whether it is going to the Kaaba, any place of pilgrimage within your heart brings you to the infinite. To learn that has been my life lesson. I thank Eruch specifically, but all of you who are in the process of living here together and sharing allowed me and helped me to come to that shore. Can you hear me with the music? Is it okay?
Yeah.
Because the music is nice. 10 years ago, Eruch brought out a book. It is a book about a slave called Bilal. It's one of the best books I ever read. And Eruch, whether it's to give me something to do, or whether he liked my voice, for whatever reason, would have me read this out. I read this book to him. He was a black slave who Muhammad saved at the point of death, freed him, and he became the voice of Islam in the sense that he made the first call to prayer. Now, Islam, you have prayers 5 times a day in millions of places every day. But the first call was made by Bilal. When I was reading this, this is so well written, I wanted to cry. It was like my emotions were all plugged up and I wanted to release just the feelings that are in this. But I would beat myself on the thigh under the table because it's the second time. Because I didn't want to, or I wasn't free enough to show that emotion of just breaking down how beautiful this is, the story of this slave. In just a couple of pages, I'm going to share this with you. And I hope I don't have to pound my leg while I read, okay? No doubt there were more handsome buildings. None of us were architects. And I can't say that I've ever stood under the dome of the Church of the Holy Wisdom in Byzantium. But what we made was a house of worship. As we rested on the floor after our labors, gazing up at the soft, dappled light filtering through the palm thatch of the roof, Hamza had one of his own fine words for our handiwork. It's like the cradle of Moses, he said, and the comparison pleased the prophet. Indeed, it was a cool place, refreshing to the spirit and pleasing to the eye with green shade. But although this first mosque was built, it was still incomplete. It was Ali, I think, who told us that it needed one more touch. We're missing something. Something high up there, he said, pointing to the roof. Some signal, a way to call the people in. We could hoist the flag up, suggested Amar. In a moment, we were all going backwards and forwards, up and down, arguing about how best it is to call the faithful to prayer. The prophet sat through it all with his arms folded, neither taking himself out or putting himself into the question. Why not use a bell? The Christians have bells. A drum? There's too much blood in a drum. A horn like the Jews? No, that's a strong note. There's too much animal left in the horn. A trumpet? We fell silent. A flag, a bell, a drum, a ram's horn, a trumpet. Nobody was satisfied. The bell jangles the ear, a trumpet splits the head, a drum thumps up the blood, and the flag goes too far in the other direction, and it would never wake a sleeper. Then I saw Abdullah bin Zaid, one of the helpers, coming forward shyly, inch by inch, so bashful that he seemed frightened of stirring the air. He, who in the next minute was going to stir the world. I saw at once that he had something to say, so I gave him my space near Mohammed. I had a dream, messenger of God, he began. And in the dream, I heard a human voice calling to prayer. He tailed off as though no one was listening. An ordinary human voice. I looked quietly at Mohammed and saw the tears that had come into his eyes. I leaned towards Abdullah. Yes. Yes, it will be so. Your dream was from God. It will be as you say. The human voice, the prophet said, and he said it so gently that I knew that his word was the last word. It was settled. But what voice? Voice? Whose? And how spoken? A soft voice? A sweet, sweet voice? A bellowing voice? My mind was racing in the possibility of voices. A child's, a woman, an old man's, a soldier's, a singer's, a scholar's. When I felt and I saw the prophet's hand on my shoulder. Your voice, Bilal. I did not first take in what he said. When I felt his hand on my shoulder, I jumped up without knowing why. My old instincts as a slave, which are hard to lose, had taught me to start moving even before understanding. I saw every face in the mosque turn to me, and then it dawned. But I, who was to become the voice of Islam, had nothing to say. Syed reached up and put his hand into mine and said something that still makes me cringe with pride. I wish I had such a gift to give to Islam. Forgive me for repeating that compliment to myself. I say it because Syed, whom I loved and gave so much, said it. Then Mohammed stood up and looked me in the face, as only he could do to a man. But I have to admit that he said less than Syed. You have the best voice, Bilal. Use it. Messenger of God, what will I say? Praise God. Declare his messenger. Exhort to prayer. Praise God. That is all. And all is enough. When the crown of his life is thrust upon a man, he does not always want it. Even Muhammad himself, when he received his call, hid under blankets. I don't compare myself when I say that I too wanted blankets, but there were none. No place to hide, no avoidance. Go up and call them from up there, the Prophet said. I looked to where he was sending me, a mud roof near the mosque. You all have seen minarets by now, how graceful the steps, how secure the balconies, how good the elevation. The muezzin can keep his breath in the climb and at the first glint of the horizon, not looking for the difference between white thread and black thread, tells him the time of the new day. But when I climbed to make that first call, I had to go up as best as I could, pulling myself up, hand, belly, knee, and foot. And even then, I was still below the palm trees. But worse, when I got up on that roof, I had nothing in my head. I had no one to copy, and no words, either to remember or forget. Yet, below me, the upturned faces. God knows that I, Bilal, the first muezzin, can tell you about those faces and how looking up at you, they lift you. The climbs were often dizzy, but the faces would never let you fall. That first time, with not a word to say, I looked back. Muhammad was near the third pillar, with Abu Bakr and Omar standing beside him. Omar so tall that he seemed halfway up the tree. The Prophet raised his hands towards me in a lifting gesture, both encouraging me and telling me to begin. Praise God, declare his messenger, exhort to prayer. Praise God, he had said. That was to be the order. I turned away and thought. Then I threw back my head into the depth of my voice. God is most great. God is most great. I witness that there is no God but God. I witness that Muhammad is the messenger of God. Come to prayer. Come to prayer. Come to good work. God is most great. God is most great. Every day now, five times a day throughout all of Islam, you hear those words. Yet I, who first spoke them, do not know where I found them. The Prophet had given me the order, certainly. And when you know the shape, you are more halfway with the words. Yet still, there must be thought. Did he, when he gestured with his open hands, give me the words? For I'll never believe that I made them up myself. I believe that the words were cast into me. Allahu Akbar! God is most great. When I came down, Muhammad brought me to sit nearest him. The people flowed around us. A bunch of children came to giggle and run away. We made a fine pair, the Prophet of God sitting with the son of a slave. For a long time, he said nothing, and I admit that I too was lost in the mystery of my own. Then he had to go to lead the prayers. He rose and took me in his arms. Bilal, you have completed my mosque, was what he had said. Thereupon, in the company of all of those people who had come into the mosque in answer to my call, I prostrated myself before God. I, Bilal, have achieved my life. Yeah.